So you came up with the topic today, elastic thinking, and how it served you in this lifetime. Go.
Well, I mean, I have a very, let's say, I just really bounce back. I don't let my environment, my situation, I don't let things I can't control, you know, whatever fish tank I'm in, I kind of have like a, what can I control? And it, you really have to keep yourself out of any sort of why me, I don't really ever entertain that.
Yes.
And that's why even though like, you know, I mean, especially being on reality TV and talking about the way I was, I grew up, you know, a lot of my, the way I grew up became like my storyline in a lot of ways, people related to it. But as a person who was like abused or whatever, I mean, I don't identify as a victim. I don't let it, I don't carry it around. And I think part of it's because I just feel very circular about how everybody has trauma and everybody's dealing with something. And at a certain point, like you were saying in the intro, I think a lot of what happens to you, you can willfully replay it and talk about, isn't this horrible? Something happened to me. But it's like, okay, but today's a new day. Look what else can happen for you if, you know, take control of your life a little bit, you know? That's how I feel.
Yeah, it sounds like what you're talking about is just resilience, which is not an automatic thing for people. It's something that we consciously choose, and not playing a victim, but, you know, kind of knowing how to actually learn from experiences or move through the experiences is resilience and what you've been able to do.
Yeah, and it's like, is there a healthy middle of like, don't live in the past, don't pretend it didn't happen. Where's that middle where you go like, I love where I am now, so I also love the first few chapters that weren't so great because here I am. You know what I mean?
Right, yeah. Right.
I always tell my mom, if you would have let me play with Barbie dolls, you know, I could have been a real estate agent by now.
Yeah.
But, you know, here we are.
Yeah.
And part of me is like, maybe this obsession with girl toys and obsession with, you know, hyper femininity came from, you know, the stifling of that as an adult. I mean, which if I had all that as a kid, I think Trixie would be like a nice girl in a flannel. You know what I mean? A nice girl with not much makeup on and a flannel.
Right, right.
Yeah. Trixie, I'm kind of curious. I don't want you to, I don't necessarily want you to have to go back and kind of like tell your full story, but what to you actually are the defining parts of your story about, you know, specifically around things that were maybe traumatic for you? For those who might not know.
You brought me here to relive my trauma so you guys could sell ad space.
Pretty much.
I know what this is.
Pretty much.
And we'll be right back with Trixie's abuser's social security number. Yeah. Right after we talk about Squarespace.
No.
Squarespace is an easy to use platform.
We're not going to be happy until you actually shit your pants live on the program. Well, until you saw yourself reliving whatever it is you went through.
Don't threaten me with a good time. Also, you showed your age twice today, Alec, when you said, I got to get my cheaters, my glasses.
Yes.
And then you're the only person besides me who calls it a program.
I'm old.
And I don't just say program. I say program.
Girl, I'm like your grandma. I'm 10 times older than you are. It's you know what? You were talking earlier about, you know, the why me thing is like, to be in this business and to be a queer person growing up, our survival depends on a certain amount on that resilience because of all the disappointments we go through. I just did a pilot for ABC. They passed. I was really attached to the income. It's being shopped around. And I have to really kind of, in order to move on, I have to like kind of acknowledge that it sucks and then kind of move on from it. Cause otherwise I'm going to be stuck in that why me thing. Like, and like now I'm already thinking what's next. And I think that as queer people, and would you agree, those are kind of survival skills that we develop as young people who are different?
Yeah. Cause I mean, of course being queer for me was complicating as a child or whatever, but you know, for me being gay was like, honestly, the least of my worries with some of the other stuff I had going on, you know, I don't really talk about it too much, but I mean, they don't even like make movies about the level of physical and sexual abuse I went through, you know, but I guess for me as an adult, speaking to what you're talking about, it's always like, this is what chunk of my life was ruined or whatever, right?
Uh-huh.
And I always just feel like I, as an adult, that thing at the grocery store you put between your groceries and someone else's.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's like, I could see those groceries. They're not, this is how much I am allowing this to occupy.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then this is all what I'm in control of. I mean, I'm not an alcoholic, but I think alcoholics talk about that thing. What is it? The courage to control, whatever, the wisdom to know what you can control.
Yes, yes.
Oh, the serenity prayer. Lord,
grant me the serenity to change the things I can and to let go of the things I can, the wisdom to know the difference. Something like that.
Yeah,
and like even as a queer person, it was like, once I realized that wasn't going to go away and it wasn't a phase, it was like, well, I can't really change that. So like, what can I do?